Okay, Peter. So last time we discussed about different type of machine learning algorithm, that is supervised, unsupervised. What do you mean by semi-supervised and reinforcement learning? So today we will be starting our first supervised machine learning algorithm known as KNN algorithm. KNN or K nearest neighbor. Full form of KNN is K nearest neighbor algorithm. Very simple algorithm. Very, very simple algorithm. And remember, it is also known as lazy learner. I'll tell you why. Lazy learner algorithm. Sometimes they may ask you in the interview, but please explain me about lazy learner algorithm. So KNN is also known as lazy learner algorithm. And the reason you will come across. You understand what is mean by KNN or K nearest neighbor algorithm. As I told you, it's a supervised learning algorithm. So labeled data we will be getting. Okay. So suppose I have two input features, X1 and X2. And this is my output feature, Y. Okay. I'm taking an example. And suppose what is happening nowadays, actually, in the machine learning algorithm, you will have two kind of problem statements. You will have two kind of problem statement. One, in which you have to classify something. That is classification. I'll tell you what you mean by that. And second kind of problem statement is known as regression problems. Okay. So two kind of problem statements are there. One which leads to the classification. Second which leads to the regression. Okay. So what do you mean by classification? Understand that. Suppose somebody gave you data like height, weight. And according to height and weight, he's asking you predict that. Predict that prediction. What do you want to predict? Based on the value of height and weight, whatever value these are having, X3, X4, X1, X3, any values. Based on these attributes, predict whether that person will either belong to a male or a female. Means some category he should belong to. Some category he should belong to. Okay. So we will classify, suppose X1 and X2 belongs to male. If the features of any person is having X1 and X2, then he will be classified as male. If he's having the features X3 and X4, he will be classified as female. Similarly, X1 and X3, if the features are X1 and X3, he will be classified as male. Okay. So classification means you have to assign one of the category to my, according to my input features. You have to assign them. You have to assign something on the basis of that. For example, I tell you male and female. Is one of the category. Similarly, someone, for example, came to the bank for the loan purpose, and he's giving the bank application. So bank application, tell me, the bank's purpose is to identify whether if I give loan to this person, whether this person will be a defaulter or not. He will be a defaulter or not. So we are classifying once again, based on certain feature, we will classify whether that person will be defaulter or not. So there are two categories, defaulter or not. So we assign them one category. Either he will be defaulter or he will be not a defaulter. Similarly, example, another example, I'm just taking right now your classification, two class classification, just two class means two classes I'm talking, male or female or defaulter or non-defaulter. Similarly, based on your health report, based on your report, you went to a laboratory where you have your lab test, and based on that report, your model has to predict the person may have heart attack or not. Again, two class classification. Again, two class classification, normally called as binary classification. Binary means two. Two class classification, but we are not only limited to two class classification. Not only limited to the two class classification. We may have multi-class classification, like three class, four class, five class, six class, any kind it can be. For example, you register somewhere in a club. Okay. And in the club, there are different categories. Suppose I'm saying that if somebody's salary, the attributes are salary, and that person is having car or not. Okay. Something like this. And based on that, you have to decide that whether the person will belong to which category means which class. Example, somebody's having a salary of 50,000 rupees per month and he's having a car. I will put him in the class two or medium class later. Okay, somebody has a salary of 75,000 and he also has a car. I will call him as a medium super class. Okay. If somebody has a salary of 25,000 and he does not have a car, I will call him as lower class. I'm just giving an example. Just take an example, right? So now how many classes are there? 1, 2, and 3. This is also classification. Mean you are assigning one of the class to a according to the attributes. Your input, you according to the input, you're classifying whether that person or whether that thing belong to which category. Is it clear what is classification? Please tell me first of all. You will assign one of the class to them according to the input features. Please tell me, clear what is classification?
Yes, sir.
Is it fine? So if suppose I'm ask you, based on certain attributes, you have to identify whether the petrol price will be increased or not increased. Only two things. Whether the petrol price will be increased or not increased. Increase, right? Increase or not increase. Decrease or is very rarely possible. That's why I'm saying whether the petrol price will increase or decrease. So it's a classification problem or not?
Yes.
It's a classification, yes, right? So when this kind of statement means belongs to certain category, these are your classification problems, right? And second kind of problems are your regression problems. You don't have to classify to one of the classes. Here are your regression problem. And here in this case, your output is continuous variables. Continuous numeric variable. Okay, continuous numeric. For example, just I asked you, based on certain features, just tell me whether the petrol price will be hiked or not. So that was classification. But I said, change now. Based on certain attributes, now tell me what will be the price of the petrol tomorrow. What will be the price of the petrol tomorrow? So of course, suppose your petrol is having right now 100.23. So it's possible, maybe determine a certain parameter, it may become 99.57. Or it may become 101.53, something with numeric data, that to continuous numeric data. Numeric, but that to continuous numeric data. Then these kind of problems are known as regression problems. For example, you can tell me now, I want to predict stock price of a company tomorrow. Stock price of a company tomorrow. It will be a classification problem or it will be a regression problem?
Regression problem.
Very good. Very good. Perfectly clear. It's a regression problem because we are trying to find out which stock price will be some numeric data, right? That to continuous. That is your regression problems. Tell me same way. I want to predict how, example, price of a house. So based on certain attributes, okay? Price of a house. So tell me.
Regression.
Very good. Very good. Perfect. I want to predict fee of a doctor. Fee of a doctor. Then it's a regression. Very good. Now, if I change, just tell me whether the fee of the doctor will increase or not increase. Then
binary classification.
Yes, classification. Now you people are clear. So normally you will get two kinds of problems, classification or regression. In regression, you will want to predict some numeric outcome. For example, house of a price, petrol price, stock price, these kind of things. Okay, you'll understand that. Fine, perfect. Is it okay, everyone? So two kinds of problems, classification, you want to classify, and second one, regression. And your k nearest neighbor is able to perform both the things, able to perform the classification and able to perform the regression problems. Both the things. And now how it works, very, very easy. Very, very easy algorithm, nothing special to do with that. See, suppose you have certain data points like X1 and X2. These are input features. Okay. And this is your output feature. This is your output feature or target variable, whatever it is, doesn't matter. And suppose I am saying it's a two class problem. Just for sake of simplicity, I'm saying two class problem. You can make a three class problem as well. Entirely. Now, certain data points are given like one, X1 is one, X2 is two, X1 is three. X2 is 1, X1 is 4, X2 is 2, X3 is 5, then X2 is 4. Now, based on this parameter, I said, if X1 is 1 and X2 is 2, my output is suppose belongs to class 1. Right? If it is 3, it is 1, it belongs to class 2. If it is 4, it is 2, it is belong to class 1. You can have increase as well. That doesn't matter. And if it is 5, it is 4. It, suppose it belongs to the class 2. I just take an example. Okay? And it is a labeled data which is given to you. It's a labeled data which is given to you. Okay? And remember, how do we do? Once we receive the data, we divide that data into how many parts? Remember? Two parts.
Two part.
Training data as well as test data. This is normally we do training data and test data. Suppose this is a training data. This is a training data and test data is somewhere kept aside. Now understand what will happen, how your KNN works. Okay. Suppose you have 4 points as we can see right now. I gave you this data as a model to my KNN algorithm. This is my KNN algorithm. I gave it to you. Now how KNN will work? Okay. When you give data to KNN, KNN won't do anything. KNN won't learn anything. It won't learn anything. It will wait for you to pass the test data. Normally, other algorithm, how? You take your training data, pass to your algorithm, and your algorithm get trained on that data. Algorithm gets trained on that data. Once it is trained, then you test your model, whether your model has been perfect or not. How? Then you send your test data to it. If it works perfect on the test data, perfectly fine, you can deploy your model. Otherwise, go back and retrain your model. Means normal cases, in the normal cases, your machine learning algorithms try to learn the relationship between your input and output. Means your output and input features. But KNN doesn't do anything like this. It doesn't try to find out any relationship. No, it doesn't work that way. That's why I'm saying that. Remember, I said that it is known as lazy learner. The person who doesn't want to learn is very lazy in learning. It doesn't try. Normally what happens, whatever output variable you have given, whatever input features you are given, most of the algorithm work how way they try to find out a relationship between your output and input based on training data set. This is how the normal algorithms work. They try to find out the relationship between your output and input. Okay. And once they have found out that relationship, they keep that relationship in that. That is known as model. Training. The model has been trained now. Once it is trained, now you can pass your test data and based on that model, it will predict whatever outcome you are having. Right? But it doesn't do that. I repeat once again, it doesn't do that. I'm repeating once again. Understand, this is very important to understand why it is called lazy learning. Suppose you have input features X1 and X2 and Y. Okay. This is your output variable. This is input variable. So normal algorithm will try to learn the relationship between Y, X1 and X2 based on your training data set, whatever your training data set. So suppose they came out with approximately 5X1 plus 3X2 square. They came out with this relationship based on training data set. Okay. So once they are able to find out that relationship, we will say that, okay, my model has been trained based on training data. So once you say my model has been trained, now you will put the new data, unknown data, which is not known to my model. And that unknown data will be having the value of X1 and X2 only. So you'll pass new value of X1, new value of X2. Based on that, some Y will come. Based on that, some Y will come. So this is known as prediction. This is prediction. You send new data to my trained model. You send new data to my trained model and basis on the basis of the learned relationship, the relationship which has been learned, this is the one. Okay, the model has been trained. It will predict what will be Y. What will be Y? How? So what normal algorithm tries to find out the relationship between your output and input. But in case of your KNN, this is not the case. It doesn't happen. Now what will happen? You are given X1, X2 and Y. Okay. And you have training data. Perfectly fine. You will pass to your KNN algorithm. KNN will sit quiet. It will not try to learn a relationship. It will wait for you to send, please send me the test data. I'm ready. Please send me. It won't find out any relationship. So when you try to find out your test data, means you want to predict something. So when you will send your test data to KNN, now this time KNN will try to predict according to the test. It doesn't learn, means it sits quiet. Now it tries to do something. When you pass the test data, earlier what happened? You send training data, your machine learning models learn relationship from that training data. And when they have learned the model, we can say our model has been trained. then we pass on our test data. Here, not the case. It doesn't learn anything till you pass the test data. It doesn't learn any relationship. It doesn't learn any relationship. Nothing, no like that, nothing. Now what it will do? Now what it will do? Okay, understand. So as I said you, suppose I have a few data points. This is X1 and X2. This is X1 and this is X2. And there are a few data points like this. Means corresponding value to X1 and X2. A few data points I'm plotting like this, something like this, suppose. Okay. Why I have taken this X and this way intentionally, so that we can identify these data points that we have marked with a cross. Let's say these, for them, the class output variable is 1. And for these data points, the class output variable is 2. For that purpose only, we have shown this. So what it does, suppose I send a new test data to the model. I send a new test data to the model, suppose, and the value of that, now what we will send? We will not send any X1, this is your model, like X1, X2 and Y, right? In normal cases, your training data is this. So X1, X2, you plotted here. And accordingly, if it belongs to class 1, we make them circle. And similarly, we pass on X1 and X2. We plotted here, and if that is supposed belongs to class 2, we marked it as X. This is the simple thing we have done. Now, we will pass our test data. And when we pass test data, we don't tell them what is the output variable. We don't tell them. That keeps it a secret. Because if you're telling them at the beginning only, this is my output variable corresponding to the test data, remember, the problem will happen. It will try to rectification of everything, which is not good. So we keep our output variable aside. We only pass our input variable. We suppose we set some value of X1 and X2. And suppose that point is here. That point is here. Okay, new point, unknown point. So I'm marking it different. So what it will do, it will compute the distance of this point from every point in the data set. It will compute the distance of this point from every point in the data set. Here, 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 every point distance will be calculated. And you know how to find out the distance normally? Remember Euclidean distance. Have you heard this word or not? Euclidean distance. Suppose, forget. Remember, these are the two points. The coordinates are X1 and Y1. X2 and Y2. How do you find out distance? Remember? Between these two points? Can you tell me? All are ingenious. Please tell me. How to find out the distance between two points? If it's X1, Y1 and X2 and Y2. Nobody knows.
Root of X1 minus X2 all square plus Y1 minus Y2 all square.
Yes, perfect. This is nothing but absolutely perfect. Under root of whatever you can say, X2 minus X1 whole square plus Y2 minus Y1 whole square. Is it fine or not? This is the way to find the distance. Everyone agree with this or not? Please tell me. Tell me, please. Sir. Okay. Yes. And same, suppose now we go to the 3D dimension, then we will have third coordinate as well. X1, Y1, Z1, X2, Y2, Z2. Then what will happen? Just increase this relationship. That's it. Plus Z2 minus Z1 whole square. So same equation can be extended to any dimension, doesn't matter. And this formula is nothing but your Euclidean distance. This formula is known as your Euclidean distance. Okay. So what normally does, if you have a numeric data, all the time you have a numeric data, this is numeric data, this is numeric data, this is numeric data, this tries to find out the distance between all the points. This point, and all the points. Okay. And after finding out the distance, it arranges them in ascending order. Okay. It arranges them in ascending order. Whatever distance calculation it has done the calculation with every data point. It arranges them in ascending order. Okay. So suppose my point is first point is A, which is nearest to this. Second is B, which is near. This is my point. Okay, this is my point, and nearest to it is A. After distance calculation, I came across. Okay, so A is nearest, then B, then C, then D, then E, then F, then G, then H, then I, then G. Whatever, how many data sets are there? How data points are there? It will try to find out distance from every point and arrange them in ascending order like this. arrange them in ascending order. Now what will happen? Understand? Till this point it is clear? Please tell me. Till this point it is clear, everything what I am saying.
Okay.
Others, yes. Please. Okay. Now what you will see? Now you will tell them, remember what was the name? K nearest. K nearest neighbors. Okay. You are trying to find out nearest neighbors. How much? K number. And that K will be set by you. That K will be set by you. Suppose I said, and normally we set K always to be, most of the time, we set to be odd numbers. I'll tell you the reason why. We normally set to be the odd numbers. So suppose I set three nearest neighbors. So you will select, you have arranged the data in the ascending order. This is nearest, this is second nearest, third nearest, fourth nearest. Suppose I said, choose K is equals to 3. So you will select only these three nearest neighbors. First thing. Is it fine? If I say K equals to 5, then you will select nearest 5 nearest. If I said K equals to 7, you will select 7 nearest. Now, is it clear? What do you mean by K for now? Why K nearest?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Perfect. Now, see what will happen. Suppose you choose these three points. So now you will check. This A is what? A is a point. A is a point in this plane. Okay. So A will be having some value corresponding to x1 and x2, right or wrong? A is a point. So it will be having some value corresponding in this plane corresponding to x1 and x2. B will be having some value corresponding to x1 and x2. C, everything will be having some value corresponding to x1 and x2 in this plane. Right. Now you will check. Whether A belongs to which class. Class 1 or 2. Okay, you will check B belongs to which class, class 1 or 2. C belongs to which class, class 1 or 2. So suppose I am saying, so just take an example. A belongs to class 1, B belongs to class 2, and C belongs to class 1. Example. Okay, we have taken three nearest neighbors. So A belongs to class 1, and that will be decided by data set only. We are not deciding. It is giving there. That's why, remember, we plotted like this. Otherwise, it is mentioned like this in the training set. Sorry. In the training set, it is mentioned itself. Remember or not? Which data point is watch class? So it will be mentioned in your training data set. Don't worry. It will be mentioned there. So we have to pick from that. Okay. This is the point. It belongs to this class. This is the point. It belongs to this class. So you will notify that. Perfect. Now, if you have chosen three. So if I ask you, out of these three, what is the probability of this point belonging to class 1. There are two classes, 1 and 2, sorry. There are two classes, 1 and 2. How many points are there in total? 3. So 3 will come at the bottom in both the cases. And what are the probability that out of these three, you will lie in the class 1? So how many points am I having? 1 and 1, 2. So the probability of belonging to the class 1 is nothing but 2/3. Agree or not? Please tell me.
Yes,
it's fine. Sir. And the probability of belonging to the class 2 is only 1/3. Agree?
Sir.
Which probability is higher?
2/3.
That means we can say that this point will belong to class 1. This is how it classifies. Is it fine? So if you can say, take the maximum vote. Who are the maximum vote? Okay, 2 persons are saying class 1. Okay, so I'll take class 1. In case opposite would have happened, suppose it would have happened, A 2, B 2, and C 1, then which class it will belong to? If A is 2, B is 2, and C is 1. Which class it will belong to?
Second class.
Yes.
Class 2.
Clear? This is the case with classification. In case it is classification. Suppose this is not a classification problem. It's a regression problem. In this case, it's not a classification problem. It's a regression problem. Then no need of probability or something like that. We don't need this. Then what we will see, okay? What value? In that case, remember your output will be not 1, 2, or 3 class. How your output will look like in that case? Some continuous variable like x1, x2. Suppose it is 1, 2, and y. Y is something 3.2. 5.5 something. Your output will be continuous variable, something like that. Okay. So now in that case, what you will do? Suppose this is A, B, C, D, E, F, G. These are the nearest point of this one. Okay. And you decided K to be 3. So again, you will consider these three. These three. Now you will check, okay, corresponding to point A, correspond X, again, A can be any value of X1 and X2 dependent upon your dating data set. So corresponding to A means whatever value of X1, X2 A is having, what is the value of Y? Note it down. Note it down. Suppose, let's say it is 2.3. I'm just taking an example. Corresponding to the B point, what is the value of Y? Suppose 3.2. Corresponding to the point C, what is the value? Suppose 1.4. Okay. So now what it will do? It will take mean of these three. That means 2.3, 3.2 plus 1.4 divided by 3. And this will be the value of your output variable Y for this particular testing. Okay. Mean or average of these. Is it fine, everyone? So what will happen in the regression problem? So whatever classes you have chosen, right? So that is the basically criteria there. Means if you're talking about the classification, so why we needed, understand, I said we have to take 3, 5, 7, 9, 11, 13, 15. I said odd numbers. The reason you got in the classification, because if I set k is equal to 4, then what will happen? Suppose I set k is equal to 4. Then if I take a k is equal to 4 and choose an A, B, C, D. And suppose A is saying class 1, B is saying class 1, C is saying class 2, D is saying class 2. What will happen? Will you be able to decide which class it belongs to? If we take K is equal to 4. If we take K is equal to 4 and these are the four nearest neighbors, will we be able to answer which class it should belong to?
No.
No. Right? This is the reason the odd number of K are normally used. So that you can make a decision. You can count a majority point. Right? That's why K is selected to be odd, but in regression case, that's not mandatory. You can guess it from here because we are just finding the mean. We are just finding the mean of that. So let's take average of these. Means whatever, how much nearest neighbor you have selected, just take average of their output value. Whatever output value they are having corresponding to Y they are having, choose them, take the mean value of that, it's done. I hope it is okay, everyone. Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
I hope you understand how KNN was. KNN, so understand, it's a lazy learner. Why it is called a lazy learner? I think that answer you can also give. It doesn't learn any relationship, right? It doesn't learn any relationship. It sits, it waits. What? Till when? Till data set is given. Give to the data sense, I will work. Until data point is given. And it's a drawback of, if you have a large data set, if you have a large data set, then using your KNN is not recommended. Reason is that because what happens in the normal algorithm, once they have learned the relationship like 3x square plus 4x2, they keep in the memory only this relationship, only one relationship, but it occupies very small memory. But KNN, when you pass the test data, it uses entire training data, right? Because it needs to compute the distance of your test point from every other training point. So it occupies large amount of memory because at when the calculation of the distance from every training point, it requires any entire training data set. And that will be loaded into your memory only. That is your RAM. So it could occupy large memory space. So if you have a large data set, it is the use of KNN is not recommended. The reason is clear. Why it is not recommended? Because at the, when you are passing your test data, so it will use your entire training data set at that time. So it will occupy large space of memory, which is not recommended. Right? In the other algorithm, what happens? Only they occupy memory when building the training data or when building the your relationship or when getting trained. Only that time they occupy memory. Once done, key one passing first test data, I don't require because I've learned the relationship, I'll do that. Test, second test data, no required, I'll directly use that. But KNN, what happens? Every time you pass new test data, it will compute the distance of your test point with the entire training data. again and again. So every time it is going to occupy large memories. Yes. That's why when your training data set is very large, the use of KNN is not recommended. These all are interview questions, what I'm telling you. What do you mean by lazy learner? When the KNN is not good? When should we not use KNN? Is it okay, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Perfect.
Yes.
Should I move ahead? Okay. So we just saw that we were able to use your distance, known as Euclidean distance. There is one more distance. I think you must be familiar with that, known as Hamming distance. Have you heard this? Hamming distance. And normally it is used when we have a categorical features. Understand. Suppose I have a feature A. I'm just giving a simple example. Second feature B, third feature C. This is one data point. This is my table. Okay, again, example X1, X2, X3. Okay, and this is my output. Whatever it is, 1, 0, doesn't matter. One or two class barely matters to me right now. And your second data point is suppose C, B, C. Okay, third data point is A, B, D. This is class 2, class 3. So again, Hamming distance will be again used to calculate the distance, but in this case, the data will be not numeric. So how will we find out? Suppose I say, find out the distance between these two points, point 1 and point 2. How will I do? A, B, C, C, B, C. Just match them. Are they equal? Is A and C are equal? Your answer will be no, they are not matching. They are not matching, right or wrong. Are they matching or not? Please tell me. A and C are, they are not matching. When they are not matching, mark it as one. B and B are matching, right? Means their distance is zero. C and C are matching, mark their distance is zero. Once you have done this, just sum them. So distance between these two points will be nothing but one. Okay. Now, if I say, find out the distance between these two points, C, B, C, and A, B, D. Can we find out? What will be the distance in this case? Can we find out the point? See, these are not same.
Zero, sir.
No, these are not same. See, A and D.
No, one, sir. Yes, sir.
One. This is same. Then zero. These are not same. Again, one.
One.
So how much distance become? 1 plus 0 plus 1. The distance is? Okay. If I find out A, B, C, and A, B, and C, you can yourself tell how much will be the distance?
0, sir.
Yes, very good. Because both are same, 0. Both are same, 0. Both are same, 0. Of course, the points are same. Okay, so this is, if that is the case, means you have this kind of data, don't worry, your Hamming distance is going to save you. They will able to find out the distance as well between the points. So in case you get a new data point, suppose this is the training data set, and you get a new data point, suppose that is A, B, and A, Z, and B. This is new data point which is given to you. So how will you do? Again, calculate its distance with every data point, with this. Okay. Calculate the distance, arrange them in ascending order. Arrange them in ascending order. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Right? Calculate the distance, arrange them in ascending order. Then according to the value of K, choose nearest neighbors. And accordingly, you can decide whether my problem is regression or classification. I hope it is okay. Is it fine, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so we got to know two important things. One is what? One is our Euclidean distance, basically works for a numerical data. And third one is our Hamming distance when you don't have a numerical data, right? There is third more distance known as Minkowski distance. I repeat once again, third one is more, which is known as Minkowski distance. distance. Right? This is Minkowski distance. Like this Minkowski distance. Anything, nothing but a, we can say everything, everything has been derived from this only. And its formula is very simple. If you understand it, it's very, very, very simple. Very simple formula it is having. Remember the formula of that one? Let me use the another slide. Let me show you on the Google directly. If I'm not writing, you will understand that. Let me open something on the Google. You can understand. Minkowski distance. Okay. Images, let me go somewhere so that we can something. Yeah. See, this is your formula of Minkowski distance. Okay, this is your formula of Minkowski distance. Summation I equals to 1 to n, where points are xi and yi. Let's say, okay, for example, you were taking x1 and x2, so it's xi and yi to the power p to the whole power 1 by p. If you make p equals to 2, if we make p equals to 2, the same formula will become your Euclidean distance. Please mute yourself. Somebody is unmuted. Okay. So what will happen if in this formula we put p equals to 2, then p will become 2 here. P will become 1 by 2 here. Remember what was the formula of Euclidean distance? Under root of x2 minus x1 whole square plus y2 minus y1 whole square plus something, 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 right? So same formula will become a formula for Euclidean distance. Same, there is one more formula known as your Manhattan distance. It should be here. Yeah. See, nothing but mod of xi minus yi ka summation. Means compute the distance between xi and yi and take the mod of that. Take the mod of that and sum all of the points. And sum of all of the points. That is nothing but same. And same Minkowski formula, is it has been derived. If we put in the same Minkowski formula, this in this case, it is shown R. If you put R equals to 1, the same formula will be coming here. Okay. So let me give a brief glimpse on now notepad so that you can understand better. So what is my formula for Minkowski? It is nothing but summation of I equals to 1 to n. Suppose I have n points. So you will mention that xi minus yi. Xi minus yi to the power p, right? To the whole power 1 by p. This is your Minkowski. Okay. If I say, please convert it into the Euclidean distance. So you have to put just p equal to 2 here. You have to put just p equal to 2 here. In that case, remember what was the formula we mentioned? If we are dealing with a 2D data, it is x1, y1, x2, y2, x, x3, y3, and so on. So remember, this is summation form. So what we are doing, we are writing like this. X2 minus x1 whole square plus y2 minus y1 whole square. Because we have 2 points, means I equal to 1 to 2. I equal to 1 to 2, 2 data points. As simple as that. Okay. I equals to 1 to 2. Then what it is saying, whatever calculation you are going to do, whatever calculation you are going to do, please sum them or take to the power 1 by 2. That's what it is saying. Right. If you see in the formula here, see, this is the formula. Whole power 1 by 2. I put it in wrong place. Sorry. I need to put it here. This way. Need to put it here. So what it is saying, calculate xi minus yi to the power p. Okay. So, and in the case of Euclidean distance, I put p equals to 2. So I did x2 minus x1 ka whole square, that is p equal to 2. Then move to the second point. Do that y2 minus y1 whole square plus 2 and whole to the power 1 by 2. So that is under root, everyone knows, is nothing but 1 to the power 2. And second form of that is Manhattan distance that you can also use for numeric data. That is nothing but summation of I equals to 1 to n mod of xi minus y. Again, formula. So you can use any formula. For numeric data, you have basically 3 options. Rather, you can say Minkowski works in every case. By default, you will see Minkowski is available only. Because in Minkowski, we have to just change the value of p. We have to just set the value of p. And same formula will become your Euclidean distance. Same formula will become your Manhattan distance. Just that for Hamming distance, it is different because in that scenario, we have to use the categorical. Is it fine, everyone? If no, yes, you can tell me. You can tell me, I will repeat again. I don't have any problem in repeating.
So one thing I would like to know.
Please.
The formula is xi minus yi the whole power p.
Yes,
but
yes.
जब हम उसको समझ रहे हैं तो लिख रहे हैं ये होना चाहिए ना x1 minus y1 का होल स्क्वायर बट यहां पर लिख रहे हैं x2 minus
no no thing is that in that case here what they have done they have taken the coordinate like this x axis and y axis something like this okay they have taken the point like this so in that particular scenario they are just mentioning one point is x second point is y they are just simply mentioning they are considering yes we have two points really And the one value is xi, second value is yi. One value
okay,
is xi.
Okay, now it's okay.
Is it fine?
Right.
That is the only thing they are doing. We can simplify it our way. You can find out, for example, a distance. Let me give an example. Suppose the coordinate is having 1, 2. Second point is having 2, 4. Okay. So suppose it says, please find out the formula of Euclidean distance. How we will do that? Under root of? You can mark it in your brain. Okay, this is x1, this is y1, this is x2, and this is y2. Okay, okay. Of course, first coordinate needs to be subtracted from second, or first second doesn't matter because we are going to do square. So how we will compute? Example 2 minus 1 whole square plus 4 minus 2 whole square. And what we will get? This will be 2 minus 1 is 1, 1 square is 1, and this is 2, 2 2 square is 4. That is under root 5. This will become my Euclidean distance. Hope it is fine in this case.
Right, sir.
Similarly, if we are trying to use Manhattan distance, that one we will say we will not take this. We will formula this way. Okay. So what is my x1? What is my x2? So again, I will do one thing. What is my x1? What is my x2? This is 1 and 2. So I'll take mod of 2 minus 1. Understand, please. That way you will understand very easily. Plus. Second point, 4 minus 2. What? That's it. So it will become 1 and it will become 2. So my Manhattan distance becomes 3. I hope now you can find that out easily. What is the Euclidean distance and how to find out Manhattan distance? Simply think. Is it fine? The formula is just a representation. That's it. Is it fine, everyone?
Right, sir. Right. Fine.
Others, please. Others. Is it okay? How to find out your Minkowski distance, your Hamming distance, and your Manhattan distance? I'm not able to hear anyone. What happened? Am I audible or not?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Perfectly audible.
Okay. Then what happened? I'm not able to hear anyone. Nobody is saying anything, single word. This happens only in two cases. Either they are not present here or they are not able to understand anything. That is the only two cases which are possible right now. Okay, so let me give you one more thing. Let me tell you one more time. Don't worry. How to calculate your Manhattan distance on anything. Okay. Suppose this time I will take my 3D data instead of 2D data. I will take a 3D data. Okay. Suppose points are 1, 3, 4 and 4, 5, 6. So we can say that this is x1, y1, z1, x2, y2, z2. If somebody says, please compute their distance using Euclidean distance. How I will compute? Simple. I'll take under root first of all. Do the subtraction of x coordinate and square them. That is, you can do 1 minus 4 square or 4 minus 1 square, doesn't matter because square is going to happen. So that will be nullified. So suppose I'm doing 4 minus 1 whole square plus subtraction of y component and a square, that is 5 minus 3 square plus third component square, that is 6 minus 4 square. I think it can be done very easily now. Please tell me. Right? So it will become 3 squared under root 9, and that is 9. It will become 2 square, that is 4, and it will again become 2 square, that is 4. So we get 8 and 9 that is under root 17. That is my Euclidean distance. Now suppose somebody says, please calculate Manhattan distance. Then how I will do? Again, first term minus second term, or second term minus first term, take mod of that, doesn't matter. 4 minus 1 mod, because mod nullifies everything. Plus second component, subtraction of these, 5 minus 3 mod. Plus third component, 6 minus 4 mod. Now you can calculate, it will become 3, it will become 2, and it will become 2. So I get 3 plus 2 plus 2, that is 7. Is it fine, everyone? How to calculate?
Yes.
Okay. In case somebody says, now see, in case somebody says, you have to call Minkowski distance with P equals to 2. He will say, sir, P equals to 2 is nothing but Euclidean distance, right? P equals to 2 is nothing but Euclidean distance. Because remember, formula was what? Here the power P and here the power 1 by P. Okay. Now suppose in this case, somebody says, compute Minkowski distance, but with P is equal to 3. So what you will do? Can anybody tell me? Points are same, but you have to compute Minkowski distance with P is equal to 3. What is the change? If you can tell me, I'll be more than happy. If you got the logic. See, simple. Put an under root sign again, but this time it will not be under root. What he's saying? P equal to 3. So it will become a cube root. Is it fine, everyone? It will become a cube root, means 3 will come here instead of 2. In square root, we normally mention 2 here. Now it's a cube root. Instead of root, find out cube root of what? Whatever he's saying. 4 minus 1, but this time not a square, this time cube. 5 minus 3, this time not a square, but cube. 6 minus 4, this time not a square, but cube. Means whatever power you will put here, just reciprocate that outside. That's it, simple. Under root means what? Remember, under root x to the power 1 by 2 means what? Under root of x, right or wrong? X to the power 1 by 2 means what? Under root of x. So if I'm saying x to the power 1 by 2 means what? Cube root of x. Is it fine or not?
Yes, sir.
I hope now with any Minkowski distance you can compute. Anything is given to you? Please tell me.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now let us go to the implementation of this. Okay. So now we are moving to the Python implementation of this. So I'm going here. I'll try to complete it. Python 3. New file. Okay. So we are going to work on the same thing now. Suppose, first of all, we have to import our necessary libraries, which are required. So remember, every machine learning thing we are going to work, we are going to work with pandas only. So we have to import our pandas. We have to import our visualization libraries, whatever are required. So suppose I am importing import pandas as PD. Okay. Fine. Import NumPy as NP. Then I will import Seaborn as SNS. Although I'm not going to use that because I'm not going to do EDA. Okay, EDA we have understood very well. Some project we will work someday, then I'll explain you, because we have done that already, right? And you can also use import matplotlib, import matplotlib dot iplot as plt, and again percentage matplotlib inline. Dot lip in that. Right? Done. Moving ahead, let's import our data set. Okay. I have a Big Mart data set. Big Mart is actually a shopping. Basically, it's very much like if you are going to the Big Bazaar or something. It's very much like that. So Big Mart is very much like that. Okay. So I'm importing that data set. How to import the data set, everyone knows. pd.read_csv. And that data set is lying inside my D drive. And I think name is bigmartsales.csv. This is my data set. Okay, available to me. So whenever I get a data set, first of all, what is my best practice? I always check, how does the data set look like? And to check it, I will use df.head. I came across, this is item identifier. Okay, means in this data set, this is nothing but I giving identity to every item. FDA 15, DRC 000 something. This is item weight. This is fat content. This is visibility. This is item type, item MRP, outlet identifier, outlet establishment year, outlet size, medium location type, other type, okay, outer outlet type, supermarket, something, something, item outlet sales. So here our task is understand, is to predict item outlet sales, understand. So whenever we receive our data set, first ask the problem, what is the problem? What do you want to do? So here our task is, remember, is to find out item outlet sales. So can you tell me it is a regression problem or a classification problem? Our objective is to find, yes, our objective is to find out item outlet sales. So it's a regression problem. We'll keep that in mind. Okay. We will keep that in mind. What we have to keep in mind, that is, this is a regression problem. Okay. And what is my output variable? And my output variable is nothing but your item outlet sales. This is my output. I'll keep that in mind. It's in my item output sales. I'm commenting it. You'll remember that for sure. Okay. Now moving ahead. Let me check how many rows are there and how many columns are there. Okay. Check that. We know that we have used df.shape. There in all, there are 8523 rows and 12 columns. 8523 rows I have, and I have 12 columns. Out of these 12 columns, one is my output variable. So I can say I have only 11 input variables. Okay. I have only 11 input variables. Is it fine till this point?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now move ahead. I came to know immediately we can conclude from that what I have 11 input variables. Out of that, we will remove something, you will come across, and one output variable. Perfect. And I'm executing now. After doing that, what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna check, okay, are there any missing values? Are there any missing value? We will do EDA. Let's see if it's needed or not. Let me check any missing values are there or not in your data set. So how will we check that? We know that we're going to check our missing values. You will be asking, sir, why we're starting with the missing values? Actually, thing is that there are two things. Remember, there are two things very important before building any machine learning model. Two important things. One, you should now have missing values. You should not have missing values. And second important thing, there should be no text columns because your machine learning algorithm doesn't understand directly text. You have to convert them to the numbers. These two important tasks. See, here we have a text. Agree or not? See, fat content is a text column. Item type is a text column. Outlet size is a text column. Location type is a text column. Outlet type is a text column. But machine learning algorithm don't understand your text. So we have to convert that into the numeric data. And before that, we have to deal with missing values, first of all. Otherwise, if you don't deal with that, your machine learning algorithm is not going to perform. Okay, right? So first thing is that we have to remove missing values or deal with missing values. So first thing should be dealing with missing value. So we will check our missing values, first of all. Remember, what are the two important things? Please tell me before building any machine learning model. Two important things which are required. I just told you, dealing with
missing values, sir, or
and second, conversion of text columns to numeric data,
numerical value.
Yes. Remember that, it keeps noted somewhere. It's very important. So how do we check? I will take df dot is null. We have studied all these things, if you remember, df dot is null and dot sum. Okay, and immediately it gave me item identifier has no null values, but item weight has 1463 values, which are missing values, right? A lot more missing values, several missing values are there. Outlet sizes, 2410. A big number is there. If they would have been a small number, we would have directly dropped those rows. Doesn't matter. We could have dropped those rows which are having missing values. But right now,
hello, sir. Numbers are,
yes, please.
Sir, actually, I have one question here. Mm-hmm. Means here you have told na the item ID, there are actually 1463 missing value are there. Okay.
Yes.
So if I here the set data frame is DF, it is defined by DF.
Yes.
Now my question is that if I want to find the maximum weight here, so it will not, it is not be possible to find it because there
maximum,
are
maximum what?
Item weight.
No, you can find out. That's not a problem. It will give the it will give the computation based on what is available.
Sir, 1463 means missing
values. These are missing values. These missing values means out of 8523 rows in my data set, how many rows are there?
8523.
So out of those rows, means if you remove 1463 rows, it's still around 6,900 rows are available.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So it will do computation based on that. No problem with that. You can
check
that.
Basically, today I face the problem because you have given the test, na?
See, it is DF. Let me check item weight only. No issue. Item weight. Okay. Dot max. Is it fine?
Yes, sir. But I don't know, sir, why I have written same comment, but it is showing problem. I don't know, sir, why.
Check okay, sir, actually, always check the error statement. What error statement is being given?
Sir, giving some key error like.
That means the mistake. Some mistake. You are. I think you have done mistake in typing your column name somewhere. Check it properly. Even if I make this W small, it will show error. See. Even if I make this W small, see, I'm getting key error.
Sir, I will check it. Okay, sir.
Okay.
Thank you.
Perfect. No issue. So we have deal with that. Now understand, we are not going to remove these rows. We are going to do imputation. Means replacing our missing values by something. That is known as imputation. I-M-P-U-T-I-A-N means imputation. Imputation. Okay. Means replacing missing values by some other values. Okay. Some other values. So what is the general criteria normally people used to follow? Let me tell you one. So you will have three kind of columns, two kind of column, numeric and something like text. Okay. So when you have a numeric data, then again, numeric data will be of two types. One, your continuous data, like 4.23, 5.63, and something your discrete data. Discrete data, maybe example, you join an organization and your ID has been given to you. Your ID will be 123, 124. Have you ever heard somebody's ID is 123.34? Right? Never. 124.56. No, you will have always a discrete number, 123, 124. You can have a finite values only, 123, 124, 125, something. And text column, you know. So how will you deal with them? How we deal with them? If that is the case, if you have a continuous data, then replace your missing values by the mean of the column. By the mean value of the column. Replace that by the mean value of the column. If you have a discrete data, replace your missing values by median of the data. This is a general trend that people follow. Median of the data. And you have a text column. Replace that by mode of the column. Mode means maximum occurrence. Suppose I'm saying text column is male and female. Okay. And I have to substitute there are some missing values in a column. Of the column is having the entries male, female, male, female, male, female. but there are some missing values. So I will type who is more, male or more, or females are more. If there are more males, that means mode is male. Substitute missing values by male. I hope you are getting my point now. Is it fine? So you have to substitute. There are three rules normally, not rules, you can say suggestions that people used to follow. If you have a continuous numeric data, replace the data by the mean of that column. If you have a discrete data, replace that column by the median of that column. If you have a text column, replace that text missing values by the mode of that text column. I hope it is clear with everyone now.
Yes.
So let us check what is item weight and what is outlet size, means which kind of column they are. And you will tell me immediately. See, I'm going here. I'm typing df dot d types. I came across that my item weight is a floating point number. It's a floating point. And what is a floating point number? Remember, 4.23 or 5.63 means continuous data. Agree? It's a continuous data. So I'm sure item weight will be replaced by the mean of that column. So we are going to delete that. Okay. Similarly, and which column we have a missing value? Outlet size. Come to the outlet size. How it is? See, but it is object. Object means text column. Object means text column or string column. And in this case, what we will replace? We will replace our missing values by our mode of mode. Right? So we are going ahead and doing same thing. Let's first of all pick the item weight. Okay. So I'm going to the item weight here. So df column name is item weight. And remember, how do we do dot fill any? Dot fill any by value equals to what you want to put? You want to take the mean of that. So I'm again calling so that you can understand. I'm calling, suppose mean I'm replacing by mean one so that we can recall. Otherwise, it may conflict with the keywords. Mean one equals to df dot weight dot mean. But that's a continuous variable. So I put mean so that I can check. Now let me check what is the value of mean after computation of that. I run that. Okay. This is the mean value. This is the mean value of df item dot mean. So what I have to do, I have to replace all the missing value. That's what you are saying here. Fill any. Use that column name dot fill any in value. Which value you want to replace? You want to replace by mean one. Okay, remember, and these things are not in place. These are not in place. You can check it inside. In place equals to false must be mentioned there. Can you see? In place equal to false. So if you want to incorporate that, copy it. Go here. Control and put in place equal to or before true. And before doing that, let me show you one thing so that you can understand better. Let me check its first 10 rows. Dot head. So that we can see missing values. Okay. Item dot head. Let me put 10 values so that we can able to see. N. Okay. Number of 10. Okay. Can you see 7th entry is missing value? N A. Okay. So let me run this and let's check it out. After running this, my all missing values must be replaced by my mean value, that is 12.857. So let me execute it. Execute it perfectly. Come down and let's check the again first 10 rows. And now check row number 7 was having missing value. Now row number 7 has been replaced by 12.85, which was nothing but my mean. Is it fine? And if you want to check, you can again go here, use this, and this thing should become 01463, which is was mentioning. Let's come here, come down and run this. See, item weight has become now 0. Is it fine, everyone?
Yes.
Okay. Next thing, what we need, remember which column is still remaining? Outlet size. So we are coming with that. Outlet. but we need, remember, we need its, it's a text column, so we need its mode. But before that, let me do one thing. Let me see first 10 rows so that we can see if any missing values there. Mode, sorry, dot head. Okay, there is a missing value in the head row itself. If you want to more, you can get it inside, and let's check it again. Yeah, several missing value, third row, eighth row, ninth row. Fine, perfect. It will give me mode. Let me save somewhere. Mode one equals to df outer size dot mode, and let me print it so that we can see here. Okay, and the mode is medium, means medium is repeating maximum times. Medium is repeating maximum time. So now what we can do, we can directly replace our missing values in this column. So I'm copying here df outlet size dot fill any. And what we need to fill, value equals to what value we have to put, mode one. And second, in place equals to run this, execute it. Let's come back again, check this columns of five, top 10 rows. Yes, still there. What happened? Okay, fine. Got it. We replace fill any by mode one. It's a mode. In, remember, in specifically in the case of mode, what will happen is that it creates a series. Okay, so series directly cannot be passed. So just put in the bracket index zero. That's it. This is the only thing that you have to do. Just pass. Remember, in case if you are putting, especially it will happen in the case of mode only, not in any other case. If you are using mode, remember to put index of zero. Otherwise, it won't work like this way. Okay. Now let me execute it again. Let me execute it, and now check please. Your third row was none. Your mode was medium, so third row must be replaced by medium. Check it. Okay. Your 8 and 9 rows were missing values. So they must have been replaced by medium. Is it fine, everyone? See and tell me, please.
Yes, sir.
Others, please. Is it okay?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It's fine.
I think I had now. Now let us see which columns are not as used. So far, I understand from the data set, this column is not of use. You'll understand why. Let me copy its name here. Okay. Let me do df of this column. Okay. Dot value underscore counts. All these functions we have studied. That's why I said, please do practice. If you don't practice, I have given you assignment as well. If you're not completing on the time, you will keep lagging behind, because we will keep on working on some new machine learning problem every day. Okay. For the next at least 10, 11 days. Okay. We are going to work on and everything new problem. And if you don't practice, trust me, nothing is going to be benefited you. So let me do that and let me check it. Value underscore counts. What it gave me, length 1559. Okay. One more second. Dot bar. Let me do. It's taking a lot of time. Let me stop it. It will take a lot of time. Let me tell you what is the reason behind that. Restart and clear output. Let me interrupt. Okay, fine. Let me tell you what. Actually, this column is nothing but an identifier, which identifies each product. Okay. For example, you are building a machine learning project to identify whose salary will increase and whose salary will not increase. Okay. Will you like to put your names there? If you like your honest machine learning model, will you like to put the name of someone? like my name, your name, or everything until you have favoritism or something like that. Will you put somebody's name or will you put his attribute? Means his result is very good. Okay. He teaches very good. He's very good connect with the students. These parameters you will put, or you will put the name only, or you will put the name along with these. Please tell me, if you're going to build a good machine learning model, will you put the name of any person? Understand the logic and tell me. If you want to predict the sales by the machine learning, not by yourself, because by human, we know, okay, that person performed very well. That person performed very well. We know by name. Okay. But machines want to learn. So will you tell them their name also? This is Praveer or this is something like that. Because what happened, right? What if suppose somebody joins new and you want whatever, he will get an increment or not. The machine doesn't know his name. He will never able to predict something. So anything, remember, any column which is an identity of unique person will never be a part of your machine learning model. Remember that thing. Okay. Any identity column is anything which can identify everything uniquely. So that column should not be included. That column should never be included in your machine learning model. Let's learn from the attributes, not by name. Not by name. Okay. For example, you understand yourself in your Titanic data set. If suppose you have given the names of every person, it is given, I think it was available there. If I remember, I'm not remember. Yes, it was available there. So will you use the name in the machine learning model? Then that person will survive or no? You will never use that. That is a unique identity. So you never use that. So we will not use item identifier because it is giving unique identity to each product. So we will not use, we will drop that column. And how to drop that column? We know very easy. It's very, very easy to drop. How? Simple, we can say df dot drop. And which column you want to drop? Remember, you want to drop your item identifier. Item, come on, come on. What happened? What's the name? Item underscore. It's not taking. Let me copy for here only. Let me copy from here. Control C and delete it. Okay, I'm putting my column name. This column I want to drop, which name is item.identifier. And how to drop the column? Remember, we have to change the axis. And axis has to be 1 for dropping the column. If we consider 0, axis equal to 0, that is row. Axis equal to 1 is column. All these things we have studied. Okay, and there is a parameter also in place equal to 2. If you can go shift and tab. See, by default, axis was 0. So we have to change it. And also in place equal to false. So we have to make it in place equal to true. In place equals to true. And now you can execute it and you can check your df.head now. Your item identifier has gone. Has gone. No longer available. You can come from here. First column was itself item identifier. Second was item weight. And you can check now your column has gone. First important thing we have done, we have dealt with the missing values. First of all, and remove unrequired columns. First thing perfectly done without any problem. Is it fine? Remember, second problem was what? We have dealt with the missing values. Second problem was what? The machine learning model requires what? First was no missing value should be there. Second was no text columns should be there. If there is a text column, convert it into the numeric data, right? Convert that into the numbers. So now we are going to deal with that. How it will do, understand. I'm telling you first method today, that is enough for this machine learning algorithm. Suppose you have a text column. So let me check this one. Let me take this column. Df underscore item underscore fat content. Dot value underscore counts. Okay. So how many categories are there in the fat content? You can see low fat, regular, LF, REG, and low fat. These are the categories available, 5 in that particular column. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to use a method which is known as dummy variables. I'm going to use a method which is known as dummy variables. What it does, understand. how many columns are there? One, two, sorry, how many categories are there in what particular column? Two, three, four. So it will create four columns now. Yes. How? Low fat. It will break one column into four columns. How? Low fat, regular, LF, sorry, five categories are there. One, two, three, four, five. I missed that. Okay. A low fat, regular, LF, REG. And again, the spelling is different. So low fat. And it will do that one hot encoding. One hot encoding of these columns. One hot encoding means once you break a one column into multiple columns according to the category. We have five categories here. One, two, three, four, five. So it will create five columns. One, two, three, four, five. And do the encoding. And that one hot encoding is what? In every row of these five columns, only one of the entries will be one. Rest everything will be zero. For example, your data set is like this. Fat content, let us take this way. In this particular row, if you go up, this take any row. Suppose this is the row. What category it is showing right now? Low fat. Okay. So when this row will come, this particular row will come, then it will have five columns in front available. So what, remember, low fat is there. So it will make low fat to be one and rest of the columns to be zero. Of this, the columns originated from this. Remember, columns originated from this, less will represent it zero. Okay. When this row will come, that is regular. When this row will come regular, then among these five columns, only this value will be one and rest of the values will be zero. When your other things will come, then those will become one and rest will become zero. This is known as one hot encoding. When your this will come, this will become one and rest will become zero. When this will become one and rest will become zero. Is it okay, everyone? What is one hot encoding? So it will see in the row, okay, what is the value? Okay, value was regular. Okay, so in that particular row, I have to put the value to be one. In rest of the columns, I have to put the value to be zero. On those columns which have been originated from my original column. Please tell me, is it fine? What is one hot encoding? Okay, also known as dummy variables. These are also known as dummy. These variables are known as dummy variables. These are not the part of your thing. Original item was what? Fat content. Now new variables have been created. Low fat, reg, LF, reg, and low fat. So your output has become function of these as well. Okay. And these are new variables created, those known as dummy variables. Dummy variables derived from this. Understand how can we deal with the text data one way? If any doubt, please tell me right now. Please tell me. And it is very easy. See, I'll show you how can I deal with that. Clear all drawings, delete this. What I'm going to say, I'm going to simply use my pandas for the same. Pandas have awesome capabilities. I'm saying pd.get_dummies. How simple is that? See, pd.get_dummies. Okay. And whose dummy variables you want, which columns dummy variables you want, pass here. So I want dummy variables of this column, which was a text column. Just put it here. Okay. Just put it here. And whatever it gives, suppose I want to see only five rows of them. So as per you, how many columns should be created from this? I just explained you. Tell me how many columns will be created. How many columns will be created?
Five.
Perfect. Only five. See, please check it. Let me check it and see what I said. In any given one row, only one is one, rest are zero. Is it fine, everyone? Please see and tell me. Is it fine?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now actually it hasn't happened in place. So instead of changing all the text columns one by one, we can do a conversion of this type in one go only. In one go only directly, we can do that. How to do that? A simple thing is that, don't worry, you can do one way. One way is that directly go, take one column one by one and one by one and place in place equal to true. If you go here and check, here they haven't mentioned that, but what you have to do, if you have to use that, means pass this value actually right now. Only this is showing what is going to happen. Actual column is right there. If you check it, if I copy this, it is right there. If you check it, see, it's right there. It is available. I don't want that. So one way of dealing with that, just pass your column name here and put equals to. This column name equals to pd.gummies of this. It will do for you. In that case, if you have 20 columns, suppose 20 text columns, so you have to repeat this process 20 times. Don't worry. Don't worry at all. There is savior. Your pd.gummies work directly with the data frame as well. It will automatically recognize which are your text columns. Based on what? Based on this data. Based on this data. We remember we use somewhere, yeah, based on here, which are my object columns. It will take those object columns and convert them into the one hot input. Automatically it will do that. You don't have to worry. Means manually you don't have to come again and do that. It will do for you. Okay. So how can we do that? It's very, very simple thing we have to do. Come here and type directly df equals to what is, this is my data frame. Okay. I'm directly want to use the data frame and save the value in the data frame. So pd.get_dummies. Okay. And pass on my data frame. Again, if you will not save it here, it will not reflect in the original data frame. That's why I put it data frame. So whatever it will be giving, that will be saved here. Now see, let me run this. Okay. And now let's check df.head. You won't see any text data now. Please check it. Everything has been converted into the numeric data. Can you see that? There is no text column which is available. Not even a single text column. Is it fine? Please tell me.
Yes, sir.
Everyone, okay? Perfect. Any doubt till this point? Please tell me. Now what we have to do, let me take 5 more minutes so that you can understand things. I don't want to leave things in between. So basic requirement have been completed. Only basic requirement we have completed. We have not removed our outliers. We have not dealt with the skewness, but your machine learning model can be built because these were the primary things which were required to build a machine learning model. So we deal with that, dealing with the text values and dealing with the missing value that we think we have done. Okay. Basic things we have done. Now our machine learning model can be done. For building my machine learning model, we require another library known as sklearn, scikit-learn. Okay. And it has several things which are available. For example, first of all, remember what I said, whenever you get the data, divide it into two parts, pin and test. So don't worry. You don't have to do it manually. It will do for you. It will do for you. Sklearn will do for you. So you will type from sklearn dot, see properly please, sklearn.model_selection. Slowly you will remember all these libraries. Okay. sklearn.model_selection, import train test split. Import train test split. So this is a function which is available for you, and this function will do splitting for you. Okay. So let me execute it, or before executing that, let me do one thing. I have my complete data set for now. If I check what happens, okay, I have complete data set with me. I have not divided, not tell even it, which is my output variable. I have not defined it, and how it will do that. Remember? So remember what was my, output variable, it was out item outlet sales. I have to tell them this is my output variable and rest are my input variable. So before splitting, we have to do that. So how I will do that? I will say, okay, X means your input features. x is equal to input features that df. I want to take complete df, but I don't want to take which column I don't want to take. So I will take df dot drop. Df dot drop, which column I want to drop. After dropping this column, I need everything to be x. And which column I don't need right now? I don't need right now item outlet sales, because this is my output variable, not my input variable. Okay. And I'll mention that I need, don't need this column. So I'll mention x is equal to 1. X is equal to 1. And I'm not mentioning in place equal to 2. Remember, because we need that output variable somewhere else. That is my output variable. That is my y variable. I will simply say df bracket and same, copy paste it here. That's it. Okay. So now what x will have? X will have all the columns beside item outlet sales. All the columns except outlet sales. And y will have only one column, that is item outlet sales. This is, these are my input features. This is my output feature. This is very important. And you can check now. If you want to check, you can check your x dot head. It will have all the columns except item outlet sales. Remember, it was at fourth, 1, 2, 3, 4, fifth position. Check, it is not there. 1, 2, 3, 4, fifth, it has gone down. Okay. And if we come here, we want to check y dot head. Please check it. It's only the outer details values. Okay. So before splitting your data set, separate your input variable and the output variable. Separate your input variable and output variable. Is it okay? This is before your splitting data into train and test. You have to separate. You could tell this is my X data or input features, and this is my Y data or output features or output variable. Is it fine? See what I have done. Says, see, you will understand it automatically. I have used complete DF except item outlet sales. Here, item outlet sales is my y value. Is it fine?
Sorry, yes, can you tell us again? X is equal to 1. Why we have taken for x?
Actually, by default, what happens whenever you want to select a column? Okay, whenever you deal with the column, you have to put x is equal to 1. Because in default, by default, it takes inside. If we go in get inside of this function, it will be showing x is equal to 0. X is equal to means that you are dropping row. See, x is equal to 0 means row wise you want to ask something. If you want to deal with the column wise, then you have to use x is. Actually, these things I've covered in the pandas section very well. And several things we did that. So x is equal to 1 simply means that you are dealing with column wise operation. So item outlet sales is my column. So I want to tell them, I don't need item, drop it. Drop entire column. Which column? Item outlet sales. Is it fine? So x is equal to 1 means column. X is equal to 1 means column. Is it fine, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Remember, so what we have done, we have taken our data set, dealt with the missing values, replaced the text column by the numeric columns, separate X and Y, input features and output features. Next thing, we want to split them. For splitting, we imported just a library right now, train test split. Okay. Now this train test split actually give me four things. X train means your input train, input training data. Understand, X train, X test, Y train, Y test. It will give me four things. Remember, any data setup will have four things. How? Let me show you. Suppose this is X1, X2, and this is my output variable Y. I'm just giving an example. It may be X3 as well. Some entries will be there, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, E, F, or something, where output variable will be there, whatever it may be. It may be something, let's say, any value. 1.2, 3.4, 5.6, something. And you may have thousands of entries that we are having X and Y. So what it will do, it will divide. It will take data randomly. Random rows will be taken. Suppose it will take first entry of this, second entry of this, third entry of this, fourth entry of this, or ninth entry of this, and mark them as your training data. and rest of the rows which are remaining, you will tell how much should be training and how much should be done. You will tell them. You will tell them. Rest will be marked as rest. Remaining rows will be marked as your test data. Okay. And once further training is there, text is there. Again, in training, there are two parts: your input features, remember, and your output feature. So this is the data of X for training will be known as X train. The data of X for the testing will be your X test. The data of Y for the training will be Y train. And the data of test for the Y will be Y test. Means suppose I choose this row for my training, this row for my training. Okay. So it will keep these thing, only these thing, not Y, in X train. Okay. Only these like A, B, C, G, E, F in one thing. And it will keep one more thing, let us say Y train. Corresponding to this, whatever value is here, suppose 1.2, it will keep in Y train. 6.6, it will keep in Y train. Is it fine? Same way with the test train. Getting the point? What is X train? What is X test? What is Y train? What is Y test? Let me explain you once more. No issue. If you're not getting, it's for the first time, it is complex. Not that complex. Let me explain you with the help of this. Okay. Now, suppose I have a data set with me, which has several features, X1, X2, X3, X4. These are my input features. Okay. What happened? Why it moved this way?
Sir, hello, sir.
Yes.
So can I leave because I have another class?
Okay, just a second. You can leave. Let me just give a glimpse. Only 2 minutes. Okay. X3 and okay, X4. Then okay, I'll go. Okay. This is X4 and this is my output variable. Okay. And this is row number 1, this is row number 2, this is row number 3, this is row number 4, 5, 6, 7. So what it will do, first of all, suppose you said, I need a test data of 20% of the overall data. Of the overall data, so suppose it has 10 rows, example taken. So it will take 2 rows for the test. You said 20% of the data should be for the testing. So it will take out of 10, only 20%, that is 2 rows for the testing, and that will take randomly. Suppose this one, this is the row for testing and this is the row for testing. So it will keep this data. This is for testing and this is for testing. So this is your row is selected and this row is selected for the testing. Okay. So if we consider only this data of this row and this data of this row, these are part of X test because these are X variables and input features and part of test data. And this is also part of test data, but this is which variable? Y variable. So this will be known as Y test. I hope it is clear with everyone now. What do you mean by X test and Y test? Is it fine?
Yes, right? Sir.
And rest of the data which is available is for the training, right? Rest of the data which is available for the training. So X, only X portion of the training data will be known as X train. And only Y portion of the training data will be known as Y. I hope it is okay now.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I'm ending. Fine. We'll continue it tomorrow. Please study it today. Study it today, whatever I have done. Please do it yourself. Otherwise, you won't be able to cope up with the pace. Fine.
Sir, tomorrow is Saturday.
No, tomorrow is Friday.
Oh, Friday. Okay.
Okay.